Okay. Good morning, everybody. My name is Beatriz Nava. I am the cultural attaché of the Embassy of Mexico, and I want to welcome you once again if you came here on Wednesday. If not, thank you very much for coming. Well, this is the second lecture that will be delivered by Mr. Santiago Espinosa de los Monteros. Thank you very much for coming all the way from Mexico to raise us with your presence here, and this is in the context of the exhibition Presence of Oaxaca Nation, which is an exhibition, a collective exhibition showing the artworks of very world-renowned Mexican artists hailing from the state of Oaxaca, like Rufino Tamayo, like Francisco Toledo, amongst many other established and emerging artists from Oaxaca. It's an extremely interesting exhibition, so I'm very glad that it came to Singapore, and very glad that you are here and can enjoy it. And today Santiago will concentrate more on Mexican contemporary art, which I'm sure will be very interesting for you. And I will again briefly read the resume of Santiago, just a little bit. No, you have to. Yeah. Okay. That's just a very brief summary of his extensive experience. So, Santiago Espinosa de los Monteros is a renowned Mexican journalist and art critic. He has a degree in journalism from the Universidad Iberoamericana and has held the position of National Coordinator of Visual Arts at the National Institute of Fine Arts Mexico, as well as Cultural Counselor in the Embassies of Mexico to Venezuela and Canada, among many others. He has written extensively in Mexican art in newspapers and specialized journals in Mexico, Venezuela, and Colombia, including Art Bands and Art Nexus. He is the author of Roger von Unten, The Innocent Precision of Chaos, and has co-authored at least a dozen books on Mexican contemporary art, in particular retrospectives on the artworks of Arturo Rivera, Anastasia Gri, Ricardo Massal, and Joy Laville. He has extensive experience as a curator as well of exhibitions featuring the artworks of Roger von Unten, Joy Laville, Luis Soto, Nina Menocal, and a retrospective of Oaxaca art. So let's welcome Santiago Espinosa de los Monteros.
Thank you for inviting me for a second time. It's a pleasure to be here. It's horrible to listen to all the things that we will never do again in the lives. When one listens to the resume that the things we did before and begins to remember, I said, no, I want to do not anymore that. But thank you very much, thank you. I'm saying that not only as a joke, I'm saying that because, and that's why that's the lecture that is going up about. Because I think that look for the real life goes always over, it goes always in front of you, not many times back. So many times when you begin to read the things that you've been writing, that you've been looking, the exhibitions that I've been creating, maybe if I do them now, if I have to do those same exhibitions, those same texts, those same things, I will do them very different, of course, because there are different situations and things. And that's why I am very, very concerned about Mexican contemporary art, because of course, in Mexico we have a very, very huge past, a very huge history about art, with the prehistoric art, with the colonial art, modern art. I mean, there are a lot of movements, and it's so very rich, and there are happening a lot of things. But we have also, of course, to know what happened before, for to do the new things. For to do new things, you have to know what happened before you were here. I mean, you can't write a book without perfect graphology, for example. For to know how to write, you have to know the rules for to write. And after that, you can break them if you want, but you have to know them. And I think that that's one of the points of the Mexican contemporary art, where we have very, very interesting people like Gabriel Orozco, like Francis Alice. Well, Francis, it's Belgian, but he has 30 years in Mexico. And that's important. You will find that many people that is now working Mexican contemporary art, and they born in similar places. They were born in the United States, or they were born in South America, or they were born in Europe. They adopted Mexico as a place to stay, the place to live, the place to work, the place to express themselves. Because they find in this, I love my country, but it's a crazy country. Has a lot of nonsense in places, but they are so powerful at the same time. It's lovely and terrible, and it's terrible because it's lovely. I mean, it's a lot of mixed feelings with Mexico. And then so many artists in the world, when they come up to live in Mexico, they find out that this space gives them the possibility to express themselves, not only in a free way, they do always express it. They express themselves in a very rich terms because there's a lot of visual information around. A friend of mine, she speaks about the iconosphere. I don't know if the term you are familiarized with. The iconosphere, la iconosfera. ¿Cómo traduciremos? La iconosfera, what's it? Well, the icons? The iconosphere. All the things that are at times surrounding you, and with the ones you are all day long eating them visually, of course not with your mouth, eating them with your eyes, and which is a very, very powerful way to express themselves, because when you see the works of the others, you are not only looking at his paintings or the sculptures or the performances, you are looking and you are receiving the way they express themselves for to talk to you. Many of these authors, for example, Alejandro Santiago or Guillermo Guin, they are very, very shy persons in the back row. Alejandro Santiago is not anymore with us. But they were people that had a lot of problems. Guillermo Guin has a lot of problems for to relate with the others. Francisco Toledo, also the one with the seeds. They are people that has a lot of problems to communicate with the others. They are like shy, they are like so simple people, they are but they do a lot of things, and the way they express themselves is with the works, with the paintings, with the sculpture, with the ceramics, with the performance. And then you find out that in Mexico it's very common to find out that people express themselves and they communicate with you with the art they do, with the works they do, which is very, I think it's very important. Of course, this lecture, I wanted to do it in terms of a very intense communication with you. I want to please feel comfortable for you to interrupt me if you have questions and things, because I want this conversation with all of you, because I know you're students. I know there are many things that you maybe are not aware about in the works, and that maybe you will have many, many questions. Please stop me if you don't understand something and say, hey, why that? Please do it. Feel comfortable to do it, because I want to have the communication with you. I think it's going to be very important. Of course, in this very, very short time, I want to be able to give you a very complete panorama of the Mexican visual arts. But what I wanted to do is I selected some of the my personal tops, maybe, of the people that is going doing painting, that is doing performance, that is doing ceramics, that they are doing sculpture. Of course, they are not all. Of course, there's a lot of more people, you know, doing very, very interesting things. But these are maybe a little bit highlights of the people that is doing things now, while we are talking contemporary people. And that's what I want to be very, very clear about, because it's people that is working now. I had to take away the salsa music before to speak, but it was very good. Do you like salsa in Singapore? You dance salsa usually? No. Okay, the next lecture we'll have a salsa class for today. Before the lecture we'll have a group here. Okay. Somebody which is now here in this place, which is Emilia Sandoval. Yes, I know. I have a PC, and I suppose all of you have a Mac. I'm sorry for that. I'm in the third row. But it works, so it's okay. It's okay, imagine, so it's a, can we maybe take off these lights, please? Yeah, it's okay, it works very good, thank you. Well, here we have a painting from Emilia Sandoval in the back wall and the left one. The one with the small plastic bags around. That's very, very interesting. Emilia Sandoval has been very concerned about the ecology of art. And she is trying to recover a lot of pieces of, for example, postcards or plastic bags and things. And she uses them in a way to express the situation of the lot of contamination of the water, of the land, the materials that are very polluted, that they make a lot of pollution in the area. In this case, these circles, they are two circles, and you have to match them. If they are from wood, very, very thin wood, you have to match them, and so you can put then you can match it, and then you can begin to sort. That's right. That was very graphic. And those, all of them, are for to sort things, and they do shirts, and they do flowers, and then she makes this as a demonstration that you have to sort another kind of histories, another kind of things. This is an installation in the gallery. It's this exhibition that was in Boston or in New York, I don't remember. This is the same artwork. The photos of the exhibition. Here, this one is very, very look-alike the one we have here now in this gallery. As you can see, the plastic things. And the Cyril she's doing all the time. And if you can notice, it's a very intimate artworks. Are not these huge paintings that sometimes you can measure the ego of the artist depending on the size of the things they do. Because sometimes they have a very big egos and they do huge things, sometimes horrible, sometimes wonderful. But it's very, very interesting to make a cooperation between the artworks, the sizes, the way they do it, and the personality of the author. It's very interesting to find out you as an ongoing artist, you will maybe notice that in your masters or in your partners. Never tell them, of course, but you can find it. Here is another one that has a lot of similarities. This one belongs to the same series of that one. with the red plastic bags, the black and white, and the ceiling and the painting with the black ink. As you can see, there are very, very small paintings, very discreet. This is part of a bag. This is a very critical one because, as you can see here, in this part, is here you can read here Televisa. It comes from the word Televisa, Editorial Televisa. Televisa in Mexico is a monopoly television. Well, we have to talk about duopoly. The two very, very big broadcasts in Mexico are Televisa and Teleazteca, TV Azteca. They both have most of the channels for television, and they are very, very, very powerful companies, because they also can do a lot of things in politics, they can do a lot of things in industry, they can do a lot of things in the laws, they can do a lot of things with the Congress, and maybe they are not in the best moment in the public opinion in Mexico. And what Emilia Sandoval makes here with her work is to put this part of the paper of Editorial Televisa, is Televisa Publishers, because Televisa is not only television. Televisa is magazines, Televisa is publishing groups, Televisa is spectacles, shows, media, special events. I mean, it's a monster. It's a monster. What she makes very, very clear with this is that also Grupo Televisa, in this case, Televisa Publishers, they are part of the pollution. They are part of the things that we have to clean out, the things that we have to take away for to survive as a cleaner country. This is very similar to the one we have here. Oh, it's a very low resolution. This is a very simple one. Plastic, and this remembers all of this remembers us the wings of the dragonfly. Maybe the 2 days ago that I was here in this gallery, there was a beautiful dragonfly in the window outside, and I was taking photos of it. It was a beautiful one. It's a beautiful one. Two artists that are doing painting in a very orthodox way, as the old way to do painting, but they are doing it in a very contemporary way. For example, one of those is Eric Pérez. which, as you can see, is a very, very clean landscape with a very good painting. They are still going outside Mexico, and they put the canvas, and they begin to paint in the old-fashioned. They look at the landscape, they paint, they look at the landscape, they paint, and they copy things, and they make a lot of portrait. It's like back to basics in painting, back to basics in expression. It's trying to do the things as the masters, the old masters did, that Manet, Goya, many of those painters, Rafael, all of them. Part of the rehearsal they had to do was to go through the landscapes, to go through the buildings, to go through the presence for to make a portrait, to go through the objects for to put them in the paintings. And so it's very interesting that now, where the painting is so contemporary and that you can find a lot of very, very new ways of expression, you find authors like Eric Perez and Daniele Sama that we're going to see after Eric, that they are putting again the eye in the landscape in this case. It's not for me. He has an incredible eye at how he manages the lights of the water inside. He's a very, very interesting painter. Maybe you can say, that could be a photo. That could be a landscape that everybody wants to do. Maybe yes, but the important part in this is that Eric decided to go to the outside and to put his canvas and begin copying the reality to put it in paint, which is very, I think it's very, very important because it's like a new position. Maybe you can notice the people here, you found it. And then it makes you a landmark of the persons that are very, very small in the landscape. When you go diving in rivers, things, and you find out this light going out the water, it's very, very, very interesting how everything changes, how the light changes. And it doesn't matter how you paint it, Eric Perez has been finding the way to make you feel that you are under the water to watch this painting. There's no sensation that you are out. You are in the water looking what he's looking right now. How you feel in Singapore when you find out paintings like these ones, they are simple, they are so quiet, they are so, how you feel, how you perceive it? I should like to know your opinion. One at a time, please.
We don't see this as simple. It's quite rare.
It's rare here? It's
well, the scenery may be not so rare, but the paintings like that of Singapore by a Singapore artist, wouldn't you say? It's quite rare.
This was the first one you saw. And there's another painter, which is Daniele Sala. Please, I want to warn you that in the Daniele Sala's paintings, sometimes there are nudity. And if somebody feels offended for this nudity, it's not my intention to do it, but I thought it was important for me to share the work of Daniele Sala because he has put in the eye in a very, very Mexican... Oh, sorry for interrupting. Sorry. For example, this is a, oh, this is very pixelated, I'm sorry. Well, for example, this is a huge painting. This is maybe 4 meters large for 3 meters tall. It's a huge painting. And all the figures in the Daniele Sala's paintings, all the figures are human size. His paintings are really, really huge. In this case, we have a group of ladies and a singer in the middle. The singer is a very well-known singer in Mexico, which is Juan Gabriel. it's an icon of the popular songs in Mexico. It's like, I think it's like kind of a Daddy Yankee, something like that, something strange. But no, it's not a rapper, of course. But he sings a lot of very emotional songs, and he cries in the sand, and he falls down, and everybody loves him. And he's so gay, but he's so funny, but he's so brave sometimes. I mean, he has this guy, a lot of personalities, so I'm a singer. And in the back, there's a lot of people that is related to the cultural life in Mexico. And as you can see, for example, here you can find the word Mexico, M. E-X-I-C-O. And at the end of the word Mexico, here is the Virgin of Guadalupe, which is one of our top icons in the religious beliefs in Mexico. And she is confronted to a very, very, very young boy with a flower in his head, with his father carrying him, like offering this young boy, this young presence to the Virgin, but in the middle is all this Mexico, which is very complicated, with the girls in this with the piano bar. This is Monet, the painter Monet from France, of course, that Lezama admires a lot. But as you can see, the composition is a very complicated composition with all these people around. And all these kind of works, they come from the muralists. The muralists were very powerful, putting people everywhere. And then if you go to Mexico and you see the murals, Diego Rivera, Siqueiros, and all of them, you'll begin to find out, oh, look, there is the President Juarez. Oh, and there is the actress Maria Felix. Oh, and here is it, because there are like a presence of the main people of your Mexico, of your country, of the time you are living. And in this case, I think Daniele Sala is doing a very interesting work in that case, trying to put people that is important in this moment in these exhibitions. This umbrella, for example, is very typical for the small vendors in the streets that they use it for the ice creams and things.
She seems like a very down-to-earth person. I mean, she's carrying something. It could be like a housewife in a sense. I mean, she would be carrying something. I'm not sure because normally the idea the Virgin is that she would give the roses to Juan Diego, and Juan Diego would be the one carrying them. And indeed, here she would be like someone very down to it, like a part of our day-to-day life. Exact part, and she is completely integrated, and it's a very interesting representation of the Virgin, and goes perfectly together with all these other elements of day-to-day life.
It's a very interesting presence because of that, what you're saying very well, that she's like a part of the party, she's part of the common life. In Mexico, many people say that before being Catholics, we are Guadalupanos, of the Virgin of Guadalupe. There's, of course, the Virgin de Guadalupe belongs to the Catholicism beliefs. She is the Mother of God, and when you are Catholic, Apostolic and Roman, you believe in the Virgin of Guadalupe because it's the Mother of God, and it's part of the beliefs of the whole Christianism. But in Mexico, more than Christians, more than Catholics, we are Guadalupanos because it's the presence of the Virgin de Guadalupe in Mexico is so powerful, and it's a kind of a mother, a subliminal mother that goes with you all the life. It's a very, very important presence. Here you will find it again. Here's again the Virgin de Guadalupe. With this suffering, also a painting from Daniele Sala, with these flowers, the Virgin, the key. And something also very, very important, Daniele Sala, that he paints the real people. We are like this. I mean, we are not like the advertisements, we are not like the people in TV, we are not beautiful, thin, blonde, which are the patrons of the aesthetics in most places in Mexico. He paints the real stuff, the real people. In the other painting, for example, as you can see, all the bodies, of course, are real bodies. These are not models. This is real people that you find in the streets, that you find in your family, that you find in the school. This is people like us, which is very, very important because it's not this very handsome guy, very strong, very normal. This is not the girls with the blonde hair. No, it's people like us, people, real people, which is very, very important in the Daniele Sala. This is bautismo,
Baptized?
It's a baptized. It's on the family in a place with the cross, of course, of the Catholic belief, and all these papers that we use very often for the parties in the small towns and the ceremonies, for to decorate the streets or to decorate the garden in the one you have to become your party, and everybody is with water onto the knees. That means also. It doesn't matter the problems we have in fruits, etc. We will keep on going with our beliefs, with our parties, with our lives, with our common lives. This is a very interesting series that Daniel Lezama did about Mr. Egerton. Egerton is this guy. Egerton was a British person, he was a traveler, and he went to Mexico, and he wrote a lot of things about Mexico, about the things that he was finding. This was in the 19th century, beginning 19th century. And Egerton was a very interesting person because thanks to him, that he did a lot of photos, as you can see here in this painting. Thanks to him, now we have a lot of documents, very important, about how it was life in the very, very small towns, in the very, very tiny places in Mexico, where Egerton was visiting them. And he spoke a lot with people, he wrote a lot, he took a lot of photographs, and he also did a lot of drawings. And suddenly, for example, he went to an ancient drawings of the Aztecs or the Mayas or whatever, and he stood there and he began to draw them with a lot of detail, with a very, very precise drawing. And thanks to him, we know a lot of the things that now are disappeared because were stolen or because some people sell them to the Muslim United States or because they were destroyed because somebody wanted to put a building there. Things that happen in Mexico, unfortunately. And thanks to Mr. Egerton, we know a lot of our past. And Daniel Lezama, with all the series of paintings, makes a kind of a homage to Egerton. And he paints all these situations about the things that he was talking about in his books. I'm gonna do it smaller because it's very pixelated. I hope you can see it better this way. Okay, this woman carrying fruits, and this guy with a cocoa, the coconut fruit, she's gonna break it. But at the same time, the revolutionary now is dead, right here. This situation here is very, very interesting because there are bodies, one or the other. And the top one is with a head cut, and they are all supported. They are supporting somebody that is dead, with the bodies painted with different colors. Blue, red, green, that you can find them also here. Sometimes for some ceremonies, for example in Chihuahua in the north, they paint themselves with colors for to represent things. It's not unusual that you can find that in Mexico. Oh, this is Daniel Lezama, the painter. This is a crazy situation with this demon carrying. Before you paint, you have to prepare the canvas, and it's with this color. And this person seems to be part of the painting, but it extends himself out of the canvas. Here, this lady, which is pregnant, and in her belly, you can find the division of the world. Each time you give birth, you give birth to a new world. Also, you give birth to a universe. You give birth it's not only a new life. It's not only your kid. It's not only your son, your daughter, or your son. It's another universe. It's another world. The one you're giving birth. This here is the Mexican cuisine, of course. The wheel of this car here. This guy in a very complicated situation, which is tied up hands, but the one is missing. It has the wire is a key. And this guy here, it's a very, very famous gallerist in Mexico. His name is Hilario Galguera. And he was not supposed to be there in this painting. Daniele Sama painted him, and when the exhibition was over, Ileto Gargara was very mad about because everybody, he was saying, they're going to think that I was paying you to do this painting for me, and I didn't pay you to put my portrait there, but Daniele Sama wanted to do it because he admires Ileto Gargara, and he's his friend, and he was free to put him in his painting if he wanted to. As you see, the themes of the flesh are very present. Like, of course, now that you see this cow open, of course, I know you are thinking in Rembrandt with this open cow, which is a very famous painting. Maybe he was the first one in painting this, the flesh as it is. And this very, very complicated studio is the old studio of Daniele Sama. That's his place. That is the place where he works. This Burning Woman is a very, very interesting painting because it's about the city. This is the center of the city. Of course, idealize it. And this Burning Woman is La Patria, is your homeland burning. Your homeland always in province, but there. And it's in feminine, I mean, it's not a man, it's a woman, because the idea of La Patria, your homeland, it's a feminine idea in Mexico. We never say El Patrio, we say La Patria, it's the homeland. We say she, not a he. And of course, it's a kind of a giant in the middle of the Zócalo, that we see in Mexico. And at the same time, we find here in the bottom a drunk man, which is here at the bottom of the beers. People looking from the top of the building, looking at this giant burning. Please note the way he paints. It's a very orthodox paint. It's a painting to tell stories, for to express things. Daniele Sama began painting, recovering a lot of very small tales in the towns, and after that he began to illustrate them, and that's how he begins to paint very dramatical painting. And now that he has maybe 50 years in doing a lot of work, he still is telling stories and doing a very, very good paint, and doing it like the muralist and very many artists before him did the painting, technically. This is ex voto. The ex votes are small paintings that people ask it to somebody to do for to say thank you to a saint or to a virgin or to God. And then in the bottom, the people write the story about why they were saying thank you to a saint, to somebody. And then you can find out, for example, thank you because a car crushed my son in his head. Unfortunately, he's not dead because I was thinking in you, Virgin of Guadalupe. So he's saved and he's in a very good shape and he's wonderful and thank you. And in honor to that, I'm giving you this ex voto. And those letters are these ones. Not in this case, I'm telling a story different. But over these letters, there are the imagines of the things about once the people say thank you to the saints. I don't know if you understood me or if I was clear. Well, I know I wasn't clear, but you understood me? Okay. And in this case, this belongs to a very important project, very large project, that was a record of a very well-known singer in Mexico, that is Lila Downs. Lila Downs made a record and a CD that calls Pecados y Milagros, Sins and Miracles. And many artists were convoked to do an ex voto for that record, and so it was an exhibition of the ex votos, and also the exposed those works in the record and in reproductions, of course, for because each one, each exposed has the name of one of the songs that Lila Downs sings in her record. And this is one of the records that Daniela San Marino. Now here you can see La Patria once again. In the back, that very big mountain you find out is El Ixtlacíhuatl. Ixtlacíhuatl means the sleeping woman, El Ixtla, I don't know how we call it in short. It's El Ixtla, and it's a very, very important mountain that is in the valley of Mexico. At the right of this mountain, it's not in this painting, of course, is the Popocatépetl. Popocatépetl, it's a mountain which is a volcano and it's very active, and very often it throws ashes, very big columns of ashes. And this is that's the left side. And this is a party, where it's La Patria, as you see, in some clouds. But it's La Patria not in a very good shape. She's a little bit naked, she's a very strange kind of woman for to be La Patria, but she's La Patria. And here in the bottom, this guy, this one, he's Benito Juárez. Benito Juárez is a very, very important hero in Mexico. In the next room, you will find the painting of Morelos Celis, with this Benito Juárez with two heads, one over and one down, in the next room. Then you can see the Benito Juárez, there it is, and the people of the town, and at the left you can see a fight with a jaguar and an animal, strange, and people. This guy here, as you can see, walking to the left, with his white thing, that is Juan Diego, that has the Virgin of Guadalupe in his clothes. Juan Diego is the guy that receives the roses from the Virgin of Guadalupe for to prove that she exists. That's what the legend tells. And as Benito Juárez is walking to the right, and Juan Diego is walking to the left, Juárez was a very, he was not with a good relation with the church in Mexico. And Juan Diego is a very reverend, it's a person that has also his church in Mexico, and it's very, very well seen by the believers of the Christianism in Mexico. And so one is walking to one side and one to the other. That's a lot of symbolism, because they would not never find each other, because they were a very different ways of seeing the real life. Now, let's go to the basements of the pyramid. I'm going to show you the works of Sergio Garbal. Sergio Garbal is a painter that lives in Guadalajara. It's a... No, I'm not going to open this one. No. Somebody's trying to hack me. Are you hackers? Somebody's hacking me? No. You can be hacking. With your internet. Sergio Garbal is a very, very interesting painter, and he paints the chaos, the chaos. He paints the terrible things that you can find out. And there are a lot of questions. Let me put them while we talk, because. This is how. This figure upstairs is made by wood, it's carved in wood. And this carve, of course, this is when he was setting up in the museum. These are made by wood. This And this is his painting. Of the priest drying his hair against a loom. That the right is Napoleon driving the horse opposite. This is a kind of a Hitler. These are his drawings, these monsters. He is an artist. He is.
Does he have any different from the German expressions?
I'm just asking about his influence. Is he influenced by the German expressionism? Because there's a lot of the traces, the brush, also the figures. Does he has any in his art?
Yes, he is influenced by the Germans, especially Otto Dix. Especially Otto Dix and the Expressionist, and also Goya in this terrible part of these nightmares and these drawings of the present, of the madness. Cows, the supermarket cars, these very absurd situations of people trying to survive. This is very interesting. Napoleon driving a horse in the opposite way. And always the church in Mexico has a terrible presence in the paintings and in the life of the authors, because church has been very, very questionable institution in Mexico. Many times very corrupt, I have to say that. Not always, of course, but many times, yes. That's why you saw that priest in the supermarket car. You can buy a priest, no problem. You can buy one. If you want, you have the money, you can buy a priest. Don't worry, it's okay. This is San Sebastian, Bono, and this girl with all the roses. Look at the priest in the supermarket car. And it's all covered by wood. This is an inspiration of a Nam June Paik installation about the videos that reflect one piece of the same person in different levels. This is while the museography works. That's why people are around. But look at the places he paints, like churches and things. It's kind of a body, which is not a body, but something she's holding. The fire back, the cars here. There's no way to escape, but there she is trying to survive over a car. Sorry, I was drunk when I took this photo. I'm sorry. It's the devastation. For example, look at this guy with all these toys. And there are some situations so absurd, so chaotic. This guy with all this belongs to a very big painting. Now you will see it complete. With a flu, with all this cojines and colchones. With all these mattresses, wet, all the toys here, the cars. Everybody with a luggage, with a wallet, trying to go to some place, but without any possibility to escape. And the quality of the paintings is incredible. When you see the paintings, they are maybe middle-sized paintings, 1 meter and a half by 2 meters. The quality of the paintings is really incredible. You can see in this Sauvage painting, for example, The Skirt of the Girl, you can see perfectly the face, the eyes, everything, and at the round, all these cows and all these absurd situations. We have the priest's tent in the supermarket car, in the water, they will go down. This is his daughter. Look at the size of the paintings. As you can see, there are no so tiny paintings there. It's a good size painting. This exhibition was held in Guadalajara. There is a place that calls Hospicio Cabañas. And it's a very, very interesting place. As you can see, it's a very, very interesting spaces, very high ceilings, so you can do very good exhibitions. Look at the carpet. Like, yes, you're a priest and you are in a supermarket car. But I'll put your car. I'll put you. Let's be correct. Let's be polite. Let's notice the size of the paintings in cooperation with the people. These figures are really powerful. These are from wood and are really, really, really powerful. Figures so well done, were craven in wood.
Why do
you
do so many with the luggage?
The idea of the luggage is a lot of, it's very important in Sergio Garban, because the luggage is always the meaning that you are in transit, that you are here just for a moment. That's why the luggage is so important for him also.
And the shopping carts?
He speaks a lot about the merchandise and about the shopping carts. That's why he puts the priests in the shopping carts. This is part of the consumption society. These are real cars that he found out in a jockey garden. Please notice the size of the paintings, it's very interesting. The priest in the flu. This is well done, so this is important. Look at the wave, the cars, everything is a mess. Now, in these drawings, you can find the before installation, the planning of the installation he did before with the cars. This is a graphic. These are drawings. Now I think this sells. Look at the drawings, it's incredible. And he paints very fast. Because when you see his paintings full of details and things, maybe you can think, oh, this guy is taking a month and each painting is taking a lot of time. And no, he paints really fast and he has a special ability. This is a very important one because of the flute, the cars, the girl with the mirror. The only thing she has for to survive is her own imagination. It's very powerful.
The cars
always be crashed cars. And I mean, it's exactly that. They are. It's like yes, if they are in, they are migrating. They are in transition. But in a way, the process it seems to be doomed to fail. I mean, the cars are already crashed. They are drowning. It's an incomplete process. At least that's how I see it.
Yes.
That's very interesting that he has this constant motif, the crashed car.
And also, not only that, of course it is, but also the car has the idea of the finito, of the thing that you can spoil it out, you can crash it. I mean, the car, which has a very, very important meaning in the Occidental society, because it means status, because it means surviving, because it means the possibility of transportation. And to move in the city. In the case of Sergio Arbal, the cars are garbage. The cars are things that are not working anymore. Also like the toys, for example. The toys are not anymore the toys for to be played. The toys are there like a part of the landscape. And when you see the cars or the furniture of a house in the water, they're in 2 seconds before everything will go down, everything will drop down to the water. How do you feel when you see the Sergio Garbal's paintings? I should like to know your opinion. You don't feel anything. You really don't feel anything. Okay, I see that. I've been taking a lot of time. Here's a guy that is very, very, very interesting. This is Jaime Rizotis. Jaime Rizotis is his studio. He lives in the border of Mexico, in the city of Tijuana, which is in border with San Diego. There are a lot of maquiladoras, the maquilas. There are many, many North American companies come to Tijuana to put the maquila because it's cheaper to produce things in Mexico than in the United States. And then a lot of companies threw away, for example, these stripes for the barcodes, I was drunk again doing that for some sort. And then Sergio Garbal picks up a lot of things from the maquiladoras, and he uses, this is Sergio, Jaime Rizotis, and he uses it to do this, these are patterns of machines. These are the levels of many machines, and he makes these landscapes. And it's very interesting because it's like using the trash to do art, to do something important. And this is a guy that is a very interesting one, very, it's a nice painter, it's okay. But his work is, goes like this, for example, I think part of the interesting things of Patrick Peterson is that all the wood colors that you see is not painted like wood, it's real wood. When he craves the paintings, then he leaves open the wood and then the rest he paints the colors and things, but the wood. Here is more clear, you see all the details here. This is a very interesting one because this is Emiliano Zapata, the Mexican hero. As you can see, these are, I'm going to show it here. Let me see if I can do it bigger. I'm going to take this out. Why I do not have a Mac? Here, for example, you can find a Emiliano Zapata, but with all the Shiva meanings, with all this art, it remembers us, Shiva. It's a very powerful. And here, you got goes around like a circle, and the bullets are gonna crush one with each other. It's like the encounter of these bullets. Has a lot of meanings, of course, the Mexican skeletons that we always, I don't know why, but we are always carrying skeletons everywhere. It's part of our culture. This dandy, and it's a toy for that he imagines. Let's go fast to what? Do we have time or we have to? Are you sleeping or can we go on? Tell me the truth. I can go on all day long, but I want to know how you're feeling. I have a lot of things to show you here, and I'm not dating in Singapore. Yeah, well, this is a very interesting author. His name is, this is in the sculpture part. He's, don't see this because it's, don't see it, don't. Don't. Okay, now you can see. this is an author, he comes from the movies, he makes a lot of movies in Mexico, and he had a lot of problems to show the directors and to show the people around in the scene how he wanted the special scene, where to shoot the cameras, where to put the lights, where to put the actors, where everything. And then he began to do boxes of acrylic, and the ones he put inside these boxes, the car, the persons, the gardens, everything. And so he began to shoot, to do the images before the movie. And then, for example, in this case, it was a scene of a drug dealer. And there was a car, there was somebody that was gonna kill somebody, and the car would open, the lights and everything. And he did everything for the scene. He did everything before. And after that, he began to do a lot of sculpture in this, with acrylics and with resinas, that's it, resin. Epoxic, this material, but as you can see, it's a very, very interesting artwork. And also it's a sculpture, it's an object, of course. It's a, and they are very, very heavy because the resin is very heavy.
Resin and a sculpture class to cast, but that's a lot of resin that would cost a lot of money.
It's very expensive.
It's very expensive. In Singapore, I don't know, in Mexico it might be cheaper.
No,
it's
not cheap.
Expensive.
It's not cheaper and
it's very heavy and it's very toxic. It's very complicated to work with it. You have to be very, very protected to work on recycling. Palau is a very, very, very respected sculptor in Mexico. She was born in Spain in the 30s. She came from Spain in the Civil War. She makes these installations, for example, this one was in the Fine Arts Palace. It calls Cascade. This, of course, the photos are not an exhibition, the photos, but We can, I mean, you are in the art business, you are going to be artists, and I don't matter that you can see the ways that the exhibitions are going set on, because it's part of the things that you are doing. But all the work of Marta Palau has been always very powerful, very to the earth, with all the materials like earth and things, which is very, very, very important. This is barro, this is clay. This work talks about the migrants that go to the other side, they go to the United States. This is her exhibition in the Fine Arts Palace in Mexico, which is the more important place to exhibit in Mexico. It's the consecratory place to exhibit in Mexico. Once you are in the Fine Arts Palace, then you can die, because there's nothing more. It's very to the earth, as you can see, very simple things, very precise and very beautiful. This flag that you see there is this size. It's a very, very tiny flag. No, you have to do your hair like this. These are varitas, wood. Who is this? Wood sticks. As you can see, they are drawings with wood sticks. They are very, very tiny drawings, beautiful ones. And so ritual. They are maybe the bigger one of these ones is maybe this size, like this. They are very pretty. This is a graphic she did in Singapore. She is now in her 80-something years old, and she's still producing, she's still doing very important things. She's a very, very well-known author. I'm very respected. I admire her a lot.
There's a lot of like an original.
Yeah, a lot. Yes. This could be African, for example.
Yes, an aboriginal like African, not like African. Aboriginal indigenous.
Yes.
Central America.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
These are warriors, for example.
Yeah.
This is a very powerful one. This is the right of you, Simon. These are dancers and warriors. And they're so simple. They're so only with very small sticks and wood. Very, very simple. Very simple. War games, that's it. Okay, I have a lot more, but I think there is no much time. What I'm going to show you is the ceramic of Gustavo Perez. I know you're going to go crazy when you see this. Gustavo Perez lives in Veracruz, Veracruz State, in Mexico. And he has been producing all his life delicate ceramics with high quality. This is Gustavo. Look at the size of the thing he's doing here. And he's an incredible ceramist. Because when you see one of his works, unfortunately, the photos are very pixelated. Sorry. When you see an exhibition from him, then you say, okay, what else is going to do now? But in the next exhibition, he makes very wonderful things and new ones. And then you say, okay, this is the end. There's nothing else he can say. And in the next exhibition, again, he once again he says new things and he makes new artworks. It's incredible. It's an artwork that is really, really incredible. And it has a lot of relation with the Oriental art, specifically with Japan. It has a lot of relation with the art of the Japanese ceramists. This is Gustavo, well, something that Gustavo. No, he usually he doesn't make series. It's one of the kind. It's one piece out there. Look at this. How the evolution of it. Show you a couple of performance from Guillermo Gomez Peña, which is maybe one of the most important performers in Mexico.
He's one of my favorite artists.
Guillermo Gomez Peña? It's incredible. It's incredible.
No, Guillermo.
Oh, Gustavo Perez. Oh, I see.
Welcome to the third world. Cortez, welcome back to Tenochtitlan. Baker, welcome to the source of the Nile. Herzog, welcome to Peru. Kogan, welcome to Tahiti. Arthur, welcome to Chihuahua. Lauri, welcome to the Barranca. Lennon, welcome to Calcutta. Viewer, welcome to my world. Free rum for all of you. To be in America is a complicated matter. You are in relation to the multiplicity of looks you are able to display. I am brown, therefore I am underdeveloped. I wear a mustache, therefore I am Mexican. I gesticulate, therefore I am Latino. I am horny, therefore I am a sexist. I experiment, therefore I am not authentic. I speak about politics, therefore I am un-American. My art is undescribable, therefore I am a performance artist. I talk, therefore I am. Period.
We've been waiting for a new essence, especially for us. New Essence Tastic Essence. Your skin is surprisingly bouncy resilient. That's never been experienced before. At this moment, my skin still feels bouncy. Age doesn't matter.
Well, sorry for that. Nobody paid me for doing it.
My favorite salsa, picante.
Write your interracial fantasies
and deposited inside the urn. Thanks for your sincerity.
Testing.
So the actual beats and that, which is very interesting because it's a kind of a performance.
But well, I think I'm already with the time here. Now it's very, very late, and I have been keeping you a lot of time here. I only wanted to share these things to you, as I said in the beginning. As part of the things, of the many things that are happening, of course, this is only a very, very tiny show about things that are going on in Mexico. And I want to make you feel that in Mexico there are happening a lot of very interesting things, a lot of very, very, very critical things. And it's a lot of a conceptual art now in Mexico going very good. For example, we have, as I was telling you in the beginning, Gabriel Orozco, which maybe you all know about him. But many people like Teresa Margoles is living, she lives in Mexico, she's Mexican. Claudia Candiani, she's there, she has the Guggenheim Award. I mean, there's a lot of people. And if you give me the visa of Singapore, I can stay here for long and speak a lot about Mexico. Which it would be a pleasure to do it. But unfortunately, in this very, very short time, this is only a show that I could share with you. I should like to know if you have some questions and comments, please feel free to do them because I want to know what you felt about this presentation. Oh, what a feeling.
Students are very shy.
Yeah, but I knew they were shy, but not so much.
And it's amazing that primary school teachers, you know, they tell people to shut up. No, she just said,
quite
good.
Quite? Quite good. Oh. Well, if there are no questions and no comments, let me make you feel that I am very, very glad to be here. Thank you again for hosting me. And I hope in the future we can meet again, maybe here in Singapore or maybe in some other place. This world is very small, this world is very short, it's a very tiny world, and I'm sure in some place we can find each other someday. Thank you for coming, thank you for being here, and thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay. Now we can dance.